Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you to our free Zoom webinar, The New Paradigm of Leadership, Allowing the Change, jointly organized by NAFI Wellness and NAFI Academy. Tonight, we have the privilege of having our esteemed guest speaker, Anna Sulaska, to share her wisdom and insights on this topic. Anna is a business and wellness coach with NAFI Wellness, registered with the Worldwide Association of Business Coaches. She has extensive experience in delivery programs in corporate culture, human values, as well as individual and organization wellness. Anna is also a yoga practitioner. And without further ado, Anna, please.
Thank you so much, Ken, for the introduction. I hope everyone can hear me well. Welcome to this webinar. The title is today, The New Paradigm of Leadership, Allowing the Change. So the key points that we are going to discuss today are the challenges of keeping talents and also all the gradual change that has been going on since a while, last couple of years in the work culture, the key factors to forming a committed team and emerging new style of leadership. Let's start with the gradual change in working culture and all the challenges of retaining talents. Recently, there is a major global shift and economic trend happening on the big scale, caused mainly by the pandemic. There is an ongoing trend in workers voluntarily resigning from their jobs. And the main reasons for that is usually the wage stagnation and rising costs of living caused by the COVID-19, long-lasting job dissatisfaction, safety concerns related to the COVID-19. So there is a lot of anxiety going on and a lot of insecurity about the future and about providing for one's living. Then we have the desire to work for companies with better working culture, leadership style, and employee benefits policies. Most probably a lot of workers these days, a lot of people, they look to shift and change their perspective, the way they perceive their workplaces, and they truly started recognizing the necessity for implementing certain changes. Now, what do employees expect? Around 63% of job seekers called work-life balance a top priority when picking a new job. Then compensation and workplace culture also matter. Low pay, lack of opportunities for advancement, and feeling disrespected were the top reasons why workers actually leave their workplaces. The source of this information, of this data, is LinkedIn's 2022 Global Talent Trends Report. So we can already see a certain trend here that it's not merely the monetary compensation that plays the key role when it comes to selecting the proper job place. More and more people look at other benefits, like, for example, work flexibility and other benefits like wellness, workplace culture. So all these things that cannot be that easily measured play more and more the key role. So how has Singapore been affected by this economic trend called the Great Resignation? Here, there is kind of tendency, also a kind of a struggle to retain the top talent. So there is a trend going on. We call it a war of talents, of keeping and gathering the talents in workplaces. It is said that Singapore hasn't been hit very hard by the Great Resignation. Nevertheless, still, a lot of organizations are facing high turnover rates and they don't know how to deal with it. And also, according to the data from the Ministry of Manpower, there has been a significant peak in job vacancies. It has been supposedly the highest for over a decade now. Another one has been in resignation from workplaces. It reached 9.9 in 2021. It has been the highest in 10 years. So you can see that everything that's been going on globally caused by the pandemic is also affecting us here in Singapore. Now, the local companies, just like everywhere around the world, has been trying to prevent this high turnover rates, and they are trying to adjust to the changes caused by the pandemic. And they started offering to the employees certain additional benefits. And what is very promising is that a lot of focus increasingly is being put on wellness and well-being benefits. Now, why do companies actually struggle to retain talents? And right now I'm going to focus only on Singapore. There is a ranking, it's called the Global Talent Competitiveness Index, which has been facilitated in 2019. According to this ranking, Singapore was 26 globally, right after United Arab Emirates and Spain, which clearly signifies that the local companies still struggle and are very weak in terms of their ability to actually retain talents. And then we have another data. It's independently facilitated survey by Robert Huff. It was done in a group of around 5,000 Singaporean job seekers, and they were questioned about the main reason for leaving their job. So 25% of them pointed out poor work-life balance as the reason for quitting the job. Then we have 24% pointed the financial rewards that weren't enough. 23% highlighted the career development that was missing and the development opportunities that weren't there. 60% highlighted the management issues or the poor leadership style. Now the last is 5% clearly pointed the working culture. And here I would like to highlight that usually the team, colleagues, workers, they don't have that much of awareness. They wouldn't point out directly that it's the working culture that is missing or it's not sufficiently taken care of. But usually they are referring to their colleagues feeling out of the place, being misunderstood, feeling lack of connection. So these are the main reasons why people decide to look for other job opportunities. Now, there is interesting quotation by Louis Garrett from Mercer. He's the Singapore's career business leader, and he recently mentioned that competing on companies' culture is becoming more and more common. So luckily, it seems like Asia is catching up on this trend with the West. And there is this recognition that working culture is becoming very important and can be a key factor contributing to winning over the company. Now, corporate culture and wellness strategies are commonly based on few factors. And let me share with you where I have this data from. When I was doing my certification for the corporate culture and wellness implementation program, I had opportunity to actually have a look at a variety of different types of corporate wellness programs and how each of them affected particular organization, how efficient they were. And I've noticed that there are certain trends for those programs that are commonly used. And it seems that companies, they really want, in most cases, something like a quick fix. And there is lack of basic understanding that we need something more than technology or one application that is going to contribute massively to increasing the corporate wellness and the culture within an organization, because shaping the culture in the team is an ongoing process that takes a lot of effort, and it usually takes several years, not only to implement the desired changes, but also to assure that they are going to be sustained. So let's have a look first at the trends that are commonly recognized in existing programs being offered for organizations. One of them is gamification. So basically we are using applications and programs remind us of games where we can get some extra points, some additional benefits each time we complete certain tasks. Then, as I mentioned, it's all based on technology. So mainly we use applications or other online platforms, but what's missing there is the human factor. Then we have incentives. So a lot of organizations, they offer extra bonuses and any other kind of monetary rewards for employees who want to participate in corporate culture and wellness programs. And the last factor most programs rely on is competition. It's connected to gamification and incentives. So it is commonly encouraged for workers to compete among each other, to collect more points, more bonuses, to complete more tasks. So I don't want to obviously judge any of these programs, and I believe each of them has different purpose and aims different aspects of organizational well-being. Nevertheless, I believe if we are focusing only on technology and increasing the competition among workers, and we base this whole program only on gamification kind of framework, it won't be as efficient as programs which are focusing on human factor and strategize the whole program in a way that it's very individualized and every employee is taken care of in individual basis. There is a personal approach because every company is very different. So we cannot find a solution that's going to fit all. Another important aspect of it is that we can often see many generations, many different kind of personalities within one team. And what works for one person won't work for another. And for this reason, if we only focus on technology, these differences in individualities will not be addressed. Now there is one very important thing that I cannot highlight enough. That's why I quoted it separately in this slide. Each time we aim to actually implement a successful culture shaping program for our organization, we need to understand this. Corporate culture, corporate wellness strategy, it needs to have individual personalized touch. Otherwise, it will not bring a significant change. So again, as I mentioned before, we cannot merely rely on technology, on applications, and expect great results. We need to approach people very personally, and it also needs to be continuous, sustained effort until we see the desired change. Then we need to provide follow-up and make sure that this desired culture that we achieved over a long period of time is sustained. Now let's talk about the key factors to actually form a committed team. I pointed out only three of them, but I think that they actually played the most significant role when it comes to creating a real cohesion in the group. So first of all, we have personalized and sustained employee engagement efforts. If we only rely, for example, on HR department to shape our organizational culture, it will not be sufficient. It usually is the employer's responsibility, but I'm not talking about only merely one person, let's say maybe the CEO, to take care of the culture. It takes every single manager, every single leader in organization to be fully responsible for their team and to also have a bigger picture in mind, to be consciously creating and shaping this culture on a daily basis. And again, I want to highlight, this is like a long-term effort. It cannot be something like one-time off kind of program implemented within one day or through one application. So these efforts need to be, first of all, understood and recognized by the managers, by all the team leaders, to be worked on a daily basis. Because each and every employee is very different and needs to be approached very individually. So we need to understand as leaders this individuality, the needs, and how to meet them, how to bring out the best in each and every person in the team. Another factor is the leadership style. In a while, I'm going to talk about new emerging leadership style. It's called the facilitative or transformational leadership. But first, let's talk about the importance of the leadership style itself. I think very often there are very old-fashioned kind of leadership trends that are still going on in some of the companies, but luckily they are slowly being replaced by this new facilitative, more transformational leadership style. And when we look at the culture within an average organization, the culture can actually tell a lot about the leader, because the leader and his style of managing people, his or her style, is a direct reflection of how this company culture is organically shaped in the organization. So if we see any weak points, anything that doesn't work as it should, it is usually, in major way, I'm not saying it needs to be the only factor, but it's very often the reflection of how the management, how the leadership is actually managing people in the organization. So whenever we are trying to implement a successful corporate culture shaping program, it needs to start with the leaders and their full engagement to participate together with their team. It's most often that this change is being facilitated from top to bottom. It's very rare, it can happen that if we have team members motivated enough and they are persistent enough to, for example, recognize that certain changes need to be made in the workplace culture that they are in, that is maybe not very healthy, not conducive. It sometimes does happen that this change can take place from bottom to top, but it's more rare. Usually, and it's more faster and more efficient When you have this recognition of the necessity to implement the changes, we should expect the full engagement of the leaders, and we should seek their understanding and inspiration so that they can actually affect the rest of the team. Now, the third factor is the work culture itself. As I mentioned, there is actually no commitment in unhealthy working culture. And it's very sad to see that in most companies, in most cases, the culture is being shaped in a very random way. Why? Because most of the leaders, even the management, not to mention other employees themselves, they don't pay attention, they don't see this bigger picture, and they just maybe feel they don't have enough time or resources or capability sometimes to take fuller responsibility. And work culture is something that should be shaped by every single member within the team. It shouldn't be only the responsibility, again, of the leaders, of the management. Let me tell you a little bit about work culture itself, because sometimes people, for some of us, it's very kind of like a vague term. Maybe not everyone understands it properly. So my biggest mentor and my organizational culture guru, the lady called Joanna Barclay, wrote an amazing book titled Conscious Cultures. She once said that company culture, if you are looking at the whole organization, let's say that organization is like a big iceberg, and then we have water level. Everything on the top of this iceberg is everything that you can actually measure. So for example, we have economic situation, we have current trends in the market, we have all the business processes that we have implemented in our company. So everything we can touch, assess, measure, derive some numbers from, and see measurable progress would be on the top, above the water level. And then we have everything, the rest of the iceberg, that is deep down beyond the water level. And here we are talking about everything we cannot measure, or at least we cannot measure and assess obviously. Here I would point out how people do things at work. So all the processes or the behaviors or the belief systems and the way people communicate with one another, certain habits that people have in the workplace, which significantly affect the way the team works, the whole company works, but usually people find it very difficult to recognize them, to measure them. And very often we can see above the water, everything is designed perfectly, everything works, but beyond the water level, something isn't working and most people never look there. That's why I cannot highlight enough the importance of consciously shaping a healthy working culture to actually make the whole mechanism work perfectly. Okay, there is one interesting quotation by John Maton. He's one of the world's top leadership speakers and coaches. And he was referring also to the importance of the working culture. So what he said is, organizations operating with the mistaken belief that they have accurately captured the overall health of their corporate culture because they have captured employee engagement through an engagement survey only, they lose a powerfully important opportunity to understand the real levers driving either strong or weak employee engagement. Based on my research, most organizations measure the engagement levels of their employees, yet very few measure their culture, yet it is the culture that drives engagement. So what John Mattoni is trying to say here is that most times companies look at the results and they tend to mistake the results for the reason, but they never actually look for the reason. So they never look at what's beyond the water level. Now let's talk about the new style of emerging leadership. And there is interesting question, could you work for free? Let me share with you a story from my own experience in the past when I still used to live in Poland. Actually, I had two jobs. As strange as it sounds, one of the job was my normal job, day one, with full salary. Another one I did for free for over, let's say around 12 years. And it was fully voluntary for me. I worked for one nonprofit organization. It is called the International Association for Human Values. Maybe some of you have heard of it. When I got introduced to this NGO, I took part in some of their workshops and programs, and I just recognized how amazingly they worked for me personally. So I recognized some benefits there for myself. So initially I just wanted to take part in their programs. And after a while, I felt very drawn to actually contribute more and more to this organization. And I was also appreciated for my input. I ended up assisting with certain programs, hosting them, facilitating them very often at my home. And I really enjoyed it amazingly. And when I recall this history with and my amazing adventure with International Association for Human Values, I just realized how much the role of the leader is important to really form amazing team cohesion, to create and form a team that would be very devoted to what they do, very committed and very inspired. It all boils down to the leadership style. And there are people like this. I'm saying the International Association for Human Values is not the only example. I had opportunity in my life to meet really amazing leaders, and it was like another level of leadership, another level of understanding how to engage people and how to make them committed. And the biggest phenomenon with this particular nonprofit organization I cooperated with was that they actually managed to gather thousands of volunteers around the world working for them completely for free. And this organization is worldly recognized as providing a very good professional level of trainings and programs. And most of the departments are based completely on volunteer work. And here you may say that it doesn't matter actually, that maybe it's a bad example because we are talking about NGO and it has different rules than a typical workplace where we are looking for obviously incentives and monetary benefits. But I just want to highlight how interesting this phenomenon is, that one person can actually inspire thousands of people to be working for him or her completely for free because this person had an amazing idea to initiate something big, to help people, to help others' welfare. For me, the lesson in participating in activities of this organization and helping them out was that if we seek for like a higher purpose, higher inspiration to really contribute to something big, then we have real fulfillment of what we do and we stay committed. And it applies to absolutely everyone. So again, it all starts with the person who has big vision. And I think that the leaders need to have vision that's way bigger than the vision of the average person for others to feel drawn to this and to want to contribute is to recognize the value there. Now, speaking of values, let me for a while talk about a model called Barrett's model. Before I go back to the previous slide, I'm not sure if any of you is familiar with Richard Barrett's assessment tool, but this person actually spent a few decades testing and developing amazing tool to assess and diagnose the organizational culture for companies, actually any kind of organizations. So thousands of companies had their culture diagnosed and assessed by this tool and by this model with amazing results. And I will be very happy to share with you some highlights about how this model works, because it can also explain a lot about this new emerging leadership style and about certain tendencies within every organization and important points to focus on when we are talking about shaping organizational culture. So Richard Barrett actually based his model, I think, as you can clearly see, on Maslow's hierarchy of needs. He modified it a little bit, but I would say the basis is the same. So we have something like 7 levels of values of the key points. So the 7 key points or levels are referring to everything that's important, that's valuable for us, both on personal level as well as on organizational level. And as long as any of these levels are weak or misfunctioning, then it needs to be targeted, needs to be taken care of properly. So let's have a look and discuss them quickly one by one. The first level, the very basic one, is called viability. So this is all about ensuring stability, sustainability of both organization and individual. So we are talking about mainly financial stability, making profit, physical safety, health. Now the second level is about relationships. So how we are forming and sustaining relationships, how healthy or unhealthy they are. It's about building the connections. It's about also the proper connections, not only within the team members, but also between organization and their customers. It's about values like respect, listening, open communication. The third level is referring to performance. So all the skills that we learn over time to achieve excellence, to achieve maximum efficiency, competence, to gain self-esteem and be assured that what we do is professional enough. We work on our quality of our products and services as a company, and we are oriented towards results. Now, the fourth level is called the evolution. And Richard Barrett called it the transformational point. I will tell you why in a while. This level is about evolving. So being accountable for our actions. As I mentioned, that's the point of transformation. It's about innovation in the business. It's about continuously learning and understand the need of continuous learning, autonomy, empowering oneself and the whole company, every individual within the team. And it's also being agile and easily adjusting to changing trends on the market. Why this point is, this level is called the transformational level? It's because Richard Barrett believed that first three levels can have their flip sides. So for example, they can work towards our welfare, both on individual and organizational level. But if we have any unhealthy tendencies, limiting or destructive tendencies, both on individual or connective level, then these things will work in destructive way for the organization. And then these weak points need to be targeted. But on the first three levels, usually us as individuals and the whole organization is mainly self-oriented. So this is about my sustainability, my health, my resources, my relationship to assure my own emotional, mental well-being and my performance, how skillful I am to prove that I'm worthy, I'm good enough, that I can provide for myself. So this is mainly self-oriented. And number four is very interesting point when there is a shift of awareness for people and for organizations. From this point up, there is this tendency to shift awareness towards the service, towards focusing on others' welfare. So let's have a look at point five. It's called the alignment. And here is where the actual magic for the team starts happening. And we start creating authentic connections with one another. There is a real expression happening. There is way more openness, creativity, integrity. There is actual passion in what we do for a living. And trust is growing among team members and between team members and the leadership. There is way more transparency and honesty. This is where people actually start enjoying working with one another and creating something. Number six is about collaboration. So we are talking about cultivating communities. It's not anymore only a workplace for us. It's something that we all collectively created. It feels like another family, work family. So it's like a real community that we feel responsible for and we shape it. We continuously shape it consciously. Here we are talking about community involvement within the organization, but also influencing communities around us as organization, forming partnerships, mentoring, coaching, creating most amazing, optimal employee experience and making employees fulfilled of what they do for a living. And number seven, contribution. I would put it like this. This is more spiritual factor of organization because every organization does have this higher spiritual aspect to it. And Richard Barrett called it a living purpose. So this is the highest form of expression. And let me first maybe read out the main objectives here is being of service, thinking of future generations, having bigger vision, having wide social responsibility, and having this wide long-term perspective. I would put it like this. It's the feeling of I was born to do this and that's just the place for me and I meant to do it because for me, that's the way of contributing to society, to people around me, to the welfare of others, and I'm affecting future generations. I'm affecting everyone in my environment, and I feel like being of service. And I'm really feeling that it's something more that drives me. It's not anymore about money, my own welfare, which is obviously equally important. But when we have this kind of highest motivation, this is where people become outstanding in the work. It's not only about perfection, it's being really exceptional, outstanding. And most of these amazing leaders, like the creator of International Association for Human Values, Shishi Ravi Shankar, they are driven and they are acting from this highest point. And I think it's amazing to encourage everyone in the team, not only the leaders, to see this big perspective. But I also want to highlight one thing, that we cannot only focus on level 7 or level 4 or level 1, whatever that would be. We need to recognize the balance and the fact that every single level needs to be addressed and met properly. Because if we don't have enough resources, but we have the most beautiful vision, we will not be very efficient. On the other hand, when our main value and drive in the organization is monetary profit, but there is nothing more than that driving us, inspiring us to wake up every day and go to work, it's going to be very short term, and we will feel a burnout, we will feel very drained after a while. So now going back to our new style of leadership, we talked about the Barrett's model, and let's go back to the style itself. I would like to tell you a little bit more about this so-called facilitative leadership. Very often people call it transformative leadership. Why? Because it drives big change for the whole company. So there is a focus, like a shift of attention, as I showed you, based on the Barrett's model, from self-interest to the common good. And those leaders who are facilitative, transformational leaders, they have this amazing natural quality of unifying everyone within the team and bringing out the best in people. So they actually listen to people, focus on their needs, and make them being the best version of themselves. They make them grow. They make them face their limitations and overcome them. Some of the qualities of these facilitative leaders are the ones that I already mentioned to you based on my personal stories. I think it's very important that these kind of leaders are very humble and understand the necessity to grow, understand and recognize their mistakes, being humble enough to admit that they make mistakes just like other team members, and learn based on them, and have this willingness, openness to transform together with the whole team. And as Joanna Barclay, the lady who wrote Conscious Culture book, beautifully said in her book itself, shaping organizational culture is an art and science. And it takes not only engaging your mind and the mind of your employees, but it also takes fully engaging your heart in it. Because the biggest leaders that I met in my life, people followed them blindly, not because they were brainwashed or they were making empty promises or any kind of promises, but they have such amazing charismatic personalities and they had this higher purpose that people really wanted to follow them, grow with them and be inspired by them. So if you'd like to know more about this transformational leadership and also about shaping the organizational culture in an efficient way, I'm more than happy to invite you for one of our signature programs we are offering under NAFILD Wellness. This program for corporate clients is called NAFILD Origin for Business. And with this program, we are inviting all the new generations of business leaders to be supported by us in shaping very efficient, high-performing, conscious cultures for their teams. When they build this amazing, optimal employee experience, they can have very high competitive advantage on the market. And some of the benefits of implementing organizational culture shaping program is increased individual and team productivity, as I mentioned before. So when we invest in the culture, the natural outcome of this will be more committed team and increased productivity. Another benefit is reduced work-related stress and anxiety, which we also focus on when we are working with your team. Improved employee engagement, efficient communication and people management. So we try to support as much as possible the leaders to help them work on their soft skills, work on their leadership style to be maximum efficient with their team, also in implementation of the working culture program. Another benefit is enhanced creativity and concentration and improved adaptability to change. Why? Because when we have a healthy, high-performing culture, the whole organization will be managing through all the possible potential crises and changes more smoothly. There will be more team cohesion and everything will work better for people. Thank you so much for listening to me. That's the end of the webinar. If you'd like to know more about our offer as NAFILD Wellness and also other programs that we are offering, you are most welcome to reach out to me on my email address or on my WhatsApp, or you can have a look at our website to learn more. And right now I would like to open the questions and answers. I can see that there are some messages on the chat. Okay, the question is, will there be any certificate provided for this webinar? No, actually not. We do offer certificates once you complete the full culture shaping program provided by us. I can give you more information if you reach out to me. Okay. I am not a business owner, but I want to know how your coaching will help me as an individual in terms of working better as a leader of my team. Okay, so if you are not a business owner, it actually doesn't matter. If someone turns to me and seeks private coaching, usually we start with something called the chemistry check. Because not every coach is suitable for every individual. We are talking about both life coaching and executive coaching here. So first we need to do this chemistry check to see if we are able to cooperate smoothly together and if I can actually help you grow and see the results in whatever field you want to focus on. After we complete the chemistry check, most times we start our cooperation by defining your objectives. So I get to know you better. I see how I can help you and we take it from there. So we create individual strategy for you to know what to focus on in long term. And upon providing solution and having individual sessions with you over time. We do the reassessment once in a while and we do the follow-up to see and measure the progress. I can tell you very like right now in general how it works, and you are most welcome to talk to me in person if you'd like to know more details. I see that there are no more questions in this case. Thank you so much for attending this webinar and being with me this evening. I hope the rest of the evening will be beautiful for you, and you are most welcome to reach out to me if you have any more questions. I will also very soon invite you for another webinar. Thank you so much.